5409, take one.
Well, it's been a while.
I know. This is a blast from the past.
Yes, it is. It'll be fun to see how we've aged since
I don't think that's happened, Emily. I look totally the same. Actually, it's this light. It must be this lighting. Hold on, let me see.
Yeah, it's the lighting for sure. For sure, it's the lighting.
Maybe this will. Hold on.
Yeah, that'll cover up those grays.
How that works? Is it better?
Oh, you're blonde now.
Just like you.
Oh, that was a good joke.
Thank you.
The joke is, for those watching, that redheads go blonde before they go gray. So the older I get, the blonder I get.
That's the t-shirt
I want. That was the joke.
I want you to have a t-shirt that the older I get, the blonder I get. No offense to any blondes out there at all. There's no derogatory intent.
No, none at all.
Okay, well, so it has been a while since we've casted Soul. So what brings us to today?
There is a person named Zay who works with the Tiny Home Youth Spirit Artworks Tiny Home Project. And Jenny Kern, who, for those of you who don't know, has been working with the Youth Spirit Artworks group for a bunch of years now, and acting as our liaison through the Justice and Peace team to the Youth Spirit Artworks committee and the work that they're doing. And Zay, I believe, we'll find out, but started in this role not too long ago. And so they are kind of making their way around the different communities who support Youth Spirit Artworks and kind of figuring out how we can be new and different kinds of partners as we move forward.
That's great. I was just the other day when I was putting together that portion of the new website, which all Soulsians, if you haven't spent a lot of time on our new website, press pause right now. Go to www.allsoulsparish.org and have a blast. It's just like stewardship for Howard Purdue. It's a great site. Emily and then Annie Rouser of blessed memory and
I yourself,
know myself, Maggie Foote. A lot of people got work on this done, and on that page you'll see lots of images of work we've done in the past with Youth Spirit Artworks and other faith-based organizations and others in building these tiny homes. It was an incredible experience last time, led by our beloved Vicky Varghese, who we love and see no longer. She did amazing work on that, and so I'm really excited to see what we might have in store for us next.
That's right. So let's bring him in.
Great.
Hey.
How you doing, Zay?
I am caffeinated. That's how I
yes.
am.
Yes.
It's my daily communion, quite frankly. I'm highly caffeinated. Yes.
How are you all? Transcendent experience.
Yes, although I'm not sure I will ever blink again, but that's all right. Great. Well, I'm so glad that we are all able to meet today. I just came from the Tenderloin, where I lead a street outreach ministry every Tuesday for Glide Church, separate from my work at YSA, or related, same vocational calling, of course. So Tuesdays are a long day. And then at 6 o'clock, I lead the Bible study at Glide on Tuesdays. So Tuesdays are a ministry full day.
Yeah, they are. Yeah. Is Glide your home church?
Glide is, I would say it's part of my church net, because I am a member at a Quaker meeting. And we have, like so many other churches in the peace tradition, we've had this diversity lag, if you will, which we've been working on. But because that's true, I wanted to be a part of church homes and families, and to be doing the work in places that also represented the diversity. So I've long had a history with Glide and Third Baptist Church in San Francisco. Reverend Brown is one of my ministerial elders, but I'm also a member, or soon to be a member, of what's a brand new kind of ecclesiastical structure among friends, which is meetings that are only for people of African descent, and meetings which don't follow the protocol of being sort of stewarded by a mothership church, kind of like a church plant, but instead just declare themselves to be such, to be a body. Mm-hmm. So I'm a part, I practice with them as well. So part of it is just to meet overall spiritual needs, but I'm still a member and continue to remain a member of San Francisco Friends Meeting.
How was it then you ended up at YSA?
It was screaming for that follow-up, wasn't it? Well, what occurred is actually one of my elders, and I think this is the way that God operates, where it wasn't a LinkedIn connection or some other self-created resume transaction, but instead one of the elders of my Quaker meeting, of the San Francisco Quaker meeting, said, hey, I know another friend, Sally Hinman, who started this cool thing in Oakland. Sally is also a Quaker, the woman who founded YSA and also had the germ of the idea for the village. You should give her a call because I think that they're doing some stuff that might align with your vocational call as well. So I called her and bing, bang, boom, here we are. And now I'm the operations manager for the whole organization. But the part that speaks to me and has been the most humbling is, rather than just working here 9 to 5, I actually live on campus, and I'm speaking to you from one of the tiny houses now, the one live in. So that's like, that's the whole thing. So I've lived here for more than a year. And so I've learned a lot and thought a lot about the ministry of others that have inspired me, like Dorothy Day primarily, who had a similar vocational calling. So it's been very important for my spiritual formation, not just the job, but sort of what does it look like to be with people who are in active mental illness, who've been in this severely traumatized situation, and frankly are not receptive to the gospel or the leadings of the spirit, maybe in the way that other people might. And so need different kinds of, what does it mean to just be with them, not try to fix them or convert them or expect something miraculous for them, but just to be with them, which is that ministry of presence is very different than a ministry of intervention and fixing people and services and all the catchwords that we use, just to be with them. So I've learned a lot. I've learned a lot here.
Wow. That's pretty cool. The rumor I've heard is that there might be a tiny home village up in Richmond that is in the works.
Yes. Yes. There's actually two. So there is one that was approved for Richmond, which Sally's working on. And there's also another one here in Oakland that my good friend Dan is working on.
Wow. Okay. So another one in Oakland. Is that just the, in terms of the building and the kind of help getting that off the ground? Are there other folks involved with that
one
as well?
No, well, they're building up their whole stakeholder list right now. But the way that they're trying to fund it, like a higher mix of private funding, and the way they're trying to operationalize what they're doing is slightly different than what we were doing. We were very clear this was going to be publicly funded. We were very clear this was going to align more with the city and with the HMIS referral system, which has changed since we opened all of that. Right. They are trying to sort of go at it from a slightly different perspective. And I think we need a bunch of different models to find out which one kind of gets the best outcomes. So I think that's good to not replicate the same thing over and over. So there's a slight difference in terms of the stakeholder set between the two.
Totally. Mm-hmm. And how about in Richmond?
In Richmond, they are working primarily through some community partners, but they're, I do not know. So how can I say this? The building of the thing is one thing. The tiny homes, the cool art, the thing, the structure, that's really important. But frankly, the thing that we found after doing the work for more than 2 years is actually the main engine of actually driving the outcomes, even with those material inputs, is the program offer that you actually have for the people once they move in. So that part, and coordinating it and collaborating with all the persons, the case managers, the other folks that are offering intervention and presence, that part is, I don't want to say more important. It's important that people have their own key. That's really important as a part of the intervention. But the programmatic lift, and to some degree, that's the expensive part, because once people move in, that stuff happens around the clock and it doesn't stop until they move out. And then the handoffs, the services, and the linkages, that's actually where the lift happens. It's after they move in.
right? It's like the difference between a house and a home. It's one thing to construct the structure, but it's provide the space for the people and how they're going to live together.
I kid you not. So I just heard an elder say yesterday that home is not a place, but home is other people. Which really spoke to me. Now, whether they annoy you and frustrate you sometime, that's beside the point. But nevertheless.
Never been in a church without that.
yes, indeed. It's the full tapestry of humanity, if you will. And so there's a bunch of different projects, but I do think for us in particular, something that matters a lot to me is if we can continue to lean on our interfaith partners to again serve as more of the presence. And that part is a little bit more tricky than just the building part, because sometimes people's expectations for what's going to happen when they're here, and you and I know this, have been, they're expecting some miraculous like experience where the heavens part and there's like choral music and they're expecting, and rather these are 18 to 25 year olds, and sometimes frankly they may just not be interested, or they just moved in, they've just gone through this really traumatic experience, and they just need time to first get their feet on solid ground. And people have to sort of lean into like what it means to not have the expectation that people will engage with you just because one of the beauties of having their own house is that they can choose not to.
Yeah.
And so when we talk about autonomy and what that really means, like the expectation sometimes in that dynamic of I'm here to spend time with you, and so basically I want you to come out and play. That part of the cultural lift of educating all of our stakeholders has been that's something that I continue to do, to set expectations so people don't have their feelings hurt, and to understand like who it is that this is not a college. It's beautiful. It looks beautiful, but this is not a college campus. Do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So understand like who we're talking about and what they've just been through.
Yep.
Okay. Well, Zay, this is all really, really good stuff. I love everything you're saying. I'm stoked on it. And we have some real logistical questions for you.
Sure.
To wrap up this time. So first question is, I hear you're coming here maybe November 18th for a meeting with the YSA Tiny Home.
Yes. Folks. Yes.
So yes. I want to know who's invited to that meeting and who should come. And then how can we partner with you moving forward?
Oh, great. Those are two. Now, see, you saved the questions right for the, I feel like I'm a contestant on Miss Universe. And then I got the question of like, how would you solve the conflict? And you're like, oh, I got 20 seconds. Okay. So, so what I'll do as to the first is I will just copy our link. You can just send that link out to folks. And then they can RSVP, and then they'll see the information and it'll, but they will not see like your address until they RSVP. So it's not like we're telling people, you know, publicly, come on over to All Souls and nobody's like, and we don't know who. The address is hidden until they actually RSVP. And that's intentional. Now, as to the second, and as regards partnering, something that would be very, very helpful, I think, to continue to leave out and at greater depth our ethos and intent of being an interfaith space is to think about ways in which the offer and the presence from our interfaith partners, All Souls and others, can be on a more recurring basis, whether it's sort of a liberation Bible study? Is it quilting? Is it gardening? Is it playing video games with the kids just to be a presence? It doesn't need to be a structured curriculum, but just to have a presence to remind them that the wider faith community is holding the space. And in whatever way we can sort of discern what that might look like and sort of co-collaborate and shape that together, I think that would be very useful in sort of speaking to our intent to have interfaith partners here and to share their values, to just be, again, like a presence beyond just the volunteering of things.
Yeah.
I'll end with, so one of the things that would be the most useful to think about, because at the advocacy dinner, this is one of the things we'll talk about. So I'll give you a little bit of a preview, is one of our, my vision would be that interfaith partners would assist on the side of helping our, both at the village itself, but also our outreach and our discussions with the city at city council meetings and et cetera, to continue shaping the policies that the city has, which sort of impact how we're actually able to do our job once people are here. For example, the response times of mobile crisis units, which is still very, very long.
All right. Well, thank you so much for your time today. This has been really fun.
Yeah.
Well, thank you all. Thank you all. I have to give credit to the coffee, really. Credit where credit is due, really. Well, please feel free to reach out to me, and I do hope to be with you all for Sunday worship soon. And again, if there's any upcoming committee meetings where you're discerning some of these issues, where it might be useful for me to join, please do send me an email. And do let anyone know that might be interested in the interfaith, the advocacy dinner, in your congregation, any laypersons or persons in the ministry who might be interested. All they have to do is like RSVP using that link.
Okay. Awesome. Thank you.
Thank you both so much.
Yeah.
All righty.
Looking forward to seeing you in three dimensions.
Woo. Wow, what a sweet guy.
Seriously. All right. So, and the work, you know, I really appreciate Jose was talking about not just the construction of the building, but what happens when you, when someone is able to live there. And how the structure they live in is as important as the structure of their lives.
Yeah.
And how to help orient and create space and community. You know, that's exactly what we found here at Jordan Court. Exactly what we found. So it makes
what we're finding
that it would be the case.
Yeah.
All right, all Soulsians. Soulcast special.
There might be more.
That's exciting. Sweet.
All right.
All right. Love you all.
Bye. Bye. Yeah.